It's August 2015, and this video will demonstrate my cider making setup. First, let me start with the apples. These are my free apples. These, of course, are early season varieties. Some Liberties, some Smokehouse, four different kinds of crab apples. All of these were picked on trees from my neighbor's yards, mostly. People who didn't want their apples, I just asked them if I could have them, and they said, of course, yes. All of these apples will be turned into cider, sweet cider, by the end of the day. This is my scratter setup. This uses the common garbage disposal method, mounted on 2x4s and a piece of spare countertop. The spare countertop I got at the local Philadelphia building supply surplus store. Makes for a great prep area for cutting of larger apples and pushing through the garbage disposal. There are a lot of online forums that say you should use a Waste King or Incinerator brand garbage disposal. The Incinerator is way too expensive at like $300. The Waste King is affordable. However, I found that the crushing chamber, the grinding chamber of the Waste King, had a large amount of basically thread locker goop in it, and I didn't want to mix that into my cider. So I ended up with a Badger 3/4 horsepower from the local Home Depot. I mounted that to the countertop. Of course, the garbage disposal is not made to mount on a garbage top, on a countertop. So the flange, as you see here, does not actually rest neatly on the top. Now, you may not find that be a big issue. I found I would have seepage between the flange of the garbage disposal and liquid would seep down underneath. So I sealed it with food grade silicone, basically aquarium silicone. Aquarium is, silicone is good enough for fish. For permanent contact, it should be fine for cider for incidental contact. I added basically a splash guard here on the side and sealed that also with silicone. Now, the big drawback to the garbage disposal method as opposed to building an actual drum size scratter is that people think that you have to cut your apples up. Well, most of the apples that I have are fairly small, being what are commonly referred to as road apples or yard apples. They fit right in the garbage disposal. Larger apples like this one, I will have to cut up to put in here. But that's really not going to be a major issue, I don't think, for me. I do have a smasher, which I made out of oak board. This will fit into the garbage disposal and allow me to smush apples down into the disposal to further along the process. It is, of course, at the height where the blades of the disposal will not impact the bottom of the wood, but even if they did, it's made out of oak, so it won't hurt anything. Now, for me, I mounted this garbage disposal with a large on-off switch, as you can see here, making it easy for me to turn it on and off. I also made sure that the power cord is short enough that it will not reach the floor. Since this whole thing is mounted on wheels, I didn't want the power cord to get in the way as I wheeled it around. All right, I'll show this in operation in a little bit, but first let's move on to the press. This is your basic Harbor Freight 20-ton press. I cannot take credit for the idea of the use of a Harbor Freight press to make an apple press. I got the idea, of course, by doing a lot of Googling and stole a lot of ideas from other people and added some of my own. And I hope that people can steal from me and make their press even better. First thing I want to point out is here underneath where the press is, where the jack is, there is a large steel rod that sticks down. Of course, that's not going to help me allow me to press anything very well. So I put some 2x4s here, extended these eye bolts through the 2x4s to keep them pressed in place so that the entire press area is the bottom of this 2x4. We'll see how well or not that this works later on. Let me show you the press plate next. The press plate is here. Again, I got this idea from somebody else. I only used 3 bars of Uni-Strut instead of 5, which I believe I saw online. And this is mounted to a large piece of particle board, laminate, basically another extra piece of wood I got from the building supply store. And hang on, I will put that in place and show you how that mounts. So here's the lower press plate in place. Notice I've marked this very center of the press plate so that I know that it's installed correctly into the press and perfectly perpendicular. On top of this, we put the juice tray, and I'll show you that next. This is my juice tray in place. It is made out of oak plywood and oak side rails. A lot of places online and other places, other videos, have a juice tray made out of aluminum or stainless steel. I attempted to do that. I did look into getting some quotes for getting a stainless steel juice tray, but at several hundred dollars, it was just outside the range of my budget. So I used oak plywood. I know there is a lot of concern about using plywood because the glues in securing the plywood together are not necessarily food safe. However, the juice is only going to contact the top of the juice tray, so I don't think there will be any contact with the glues at all. I have polyurethane the whole thing in addition to that, which will protect it, as well as used clear silicone, food grade silicone, along the edges to keep the juice out. My drain hole, which was a big concern of mine, is basically just a drilled hole with a piece of PVC pipe stuck in there. That's it. Nothing fancy, no fancy schmancy. However, it might be a little small, depending on how much juice I'm pushing out. We'll see once I get that made. The next step is, of course, the racks. Now, if you are to purchase racks, they're going to cost you probably $10 to $20 each. That was just outside of my budget. I noticed in one of Reverend Nat's videos that he was using bread trays. So I was able to secure some bread trays off of eBay for about $5 each, which is still pretty expensive to me, but I was able to get 10 trays for like $50. So I cut the sides down, and hopefully these will work fine. Note that a lot of bakeries are shifting over to cardboard press tray bread trays now, so it's hard to get the plastic ones, but if you have a source, I highly suggest you grab them. The next step, of course, is going to be my former. My form is oak. Just some oak boards I bought at Home Depot and screwed together. Hopefully this will work fine. I'm a little concerned that it might be a little bit on the large size, but I think it'll be okay. And we'll see that in operation a little bit later. Next, of course, is the press cloths. And let me grab one of those and I'll show you how those work. Before I show you the press cloths, I wanted to note on my juice tray here that I've got a cutout in the side of the plywood that fits right around the arm of the press so that it fits perfectly in the center every time and I don't have to worry about it being lopsided. I highly recommend this. I got this idea from one of the other online videos, so hopefully you can adapt that as well. As for press cloths, again, if you were to go out and buy a press cloth that's custom made specifically for apple pressing, they're going to cost you about $10 to $12 each. Depending on the size of your press, you're going to need anywhere from 5 to 10 or 15 of these. That can run into some serious coin very quickly. So a lot of places online, a lot of forum posts just say, hey, use some old curtains. So I'm like, well, curtains, how do you get curtains? Where are you going to get curtains? Curtains themselves are expensive as well. So I found online a bulk fabric store, and I found this, it's polyester vole curtain material. That I got for $2 a yard at 108 inches wide. I got 5 yards, chopped it up. I ended up with like 12 press cloths for like $2 each. Really can't be beat. I've used these already. They seem to work great. I have not used them in the press yet, but hopefully we'll see how they function today. Again, I recommend the polyester as opposed to a cotton because with the polyester you can burn the edges to prevent them from fraying. If you get cotton, you're either going to have to deal with the frays or hem the edges, which is time-consuming and a pain in the butt. And I don't have a sewing machine. So I got polyester and I burnt the edges. Makes well. So again, what we'll do is we'll put the pomace in here. We'll fold the press cloth over, right? Like so. We'll pull the form out. We'll add another rack. then we put the form back in, another press cloth, and more pumice, and then we lower the press. All right, so that's my setup. I will show you how in operation as we get going today, and press grinding and pressing some apples. Okay, one thing I've learned on experimentation is that sometimes, even though the apples are small enough to fit into the garbage disposal, they don't really like being run around inside the disposal because they're too big. So a French fry maker will make short work of chopping those apples up to a decent size that can then go through the garbage disposal. Here's the last of our cheeses. We already have 6 gallons of cider, probably 7, and we haven't even begun pressing. We'll fold our cheesecloth, our press cloth, our curtains up over the top of the last cheese. Remove the form. Put the last bread tray on top. And for a top plate, I'm using a piece of plywood that's been laminated again from the home. Oops, sorry about that. From the home home building supply surplus store. So there's our cheese, completely built, and we're going to put some 4x4s on top. We have begun pressing now, and the juice is flowing quite freely, and everything seems to be working as planned. As I suspected, my drain hole is a little bit on the small side, as my juice tray is starting to fill, so I will slow down the pressing. This is a good point to tell you next year's upgrades, starting with the jack, which will become an air jack, so that I don't have to pump it up and down manually. In addition, we may get an aluminum or stainless steel press tray. I suspect that I will get a tray that is extremely long, so that I can have 3 cheeses in production at once, one cheese being built, one cheese being pressed, and one cheese being taken down. I did notice that the garbage disposal did overheat, and I think but the problem isn't so much that I ran it too long continuously, but that the apples that I was trying to run through there were too hard and was clogging the garbage disposal, causing it to overwork. A 1 horsepower garbage disposal would have definitely been preferred over this 3/4 horsepower, but it's usable and doable for me now. I think if I was going to do more than, say, 10 bushels a day, I would want to have a different scratter in place, an actual drum scratter, as opposed to the garbage disposal. But for 5 to 10 bushels, which is what I'm doing, the garbage disposal is quick and easy and inexpensive. So total investment here is about $400, maybe a little bit over that, The Harbor Freight Press itself was $130. The garbage disposal was $130. My racks, my bread trays was $50. So that's already $260, $310. Add on miscellaneous costs for oak. Oak is not cheap. And some 2x4s, and we get right up to around $400. However, the apples were free, and I can use this press over and over again every year to make more and more apple cider. You'll notice that the cheeses have become greatly compressed. So there's a foot and a half or so of what used to be apple pumice is now juice in my bucket. The cheeses themselves have become extremely compressed, and the juice flow has slowed to but a trickle. It's still flowing, just not as much. We'll let it sit here for a few minutes, hopefully, and fill this bucket, and we'll call it a day.